What's up, guys? How's it going? Bogla here again with another episode in Creativerse, getting into some of the logic stuff. I am joined here today with Big Rebel. How's it going, Big Rebel?
All good.
All right, so today we are going to be looking at arc signs as well as keypads and your combination locks. The reason that I'm going to kind of do these two together is because of the fact of actually there's some pretty cool stuff that you can do with these keypads involving these arc signs. You can use those keypads to change colors and put out different displays and whatever all else. All right, so let's just go ahead and dive right in here. Big Rebel, you got any questions on arc signs? Anything that you've seen me do? Anything that you want to see me do? All that sort of craziness? Any projects that you're working
some
on?
Some of the things, a copy of one of the things you did on one of my signs for me, pretty much, let's see, I have to look here. Oh, you got to get me an interactor and be able to interact with the sign.
Oop. Yeah,
so I can actually look at the stuff too.
Get on in there and change that for you. Here you go.
Okay. Well, basically, line one, line two, changing the name of the sign, you don't need a touch to know that, right?
Yeah, that's all normal stuff, and we'll go really into that. Like, I'm going to do the size change, the offsets, the colors.
Okay.
All that fun stuff.
Pretty much all I got everything I needed all to do with that. I just basically go over the colors and stuff.
Okay.
And stuff.
Just your normal movements, colors, sizes, that sort of stuff?
Yeah.
All right. So there is going to be a fair bit of deeper, heavier logic side of this stuff that I am going to get into. So let's just go ahead and dive right on in, guys. So there are the couple of different ways that you can turn these signs on. One being, come on, dig it up, put it down, not two of them. Jeez, what am I doing already? So, we got a sensor, we got a pressure plate, we got a keypad over there. Let's throw it on a switch as well. So now let's grab our wiring tool. What we can do is we can actually hook one of these up to each one of these different nodes. We'll just leave it turned on for right now. And we'll just show you guys how each one of these different things connect and give different outputs. So let's just go ahead and flip everything so everything is reading a zero at least. Make sure that that's set for a 1 second. We'll go ahead and put that in there because that's actually not going to matter at all. Alright, so right now you see input 1, 2, 3, and 4 all reading zeros. That's because everything is currently turned off. Step in the sensor, it's going to read a 1 on input 4, which is where that's plugged in. Step on the pressure plate, it's going to read a 1 on input 3, where that is. Switch on 1, and this one here, I don't know if it's just going to send, I think, whatever I enter. Yeah, so it's going to do a 5 on input 2, so long as that is on. So actually, let me just turn this off, because then that should read permanently until I change it again. So if I do a 5, input 2 now reads 5 until I do something else. Alright, so now the fun stuff with signs. That gets real crazy, real interesting, real quick. So, Rebel, what kind of a message should I say here? What do we want to do? Do we want to do multiple messages on this one? Do we want to do the sizes, colors?
Let's do size and colors.
Size and colors? Alright, so we'll just do a generic welcome. Alright, so if we just do a generic welcome, it's going to be on no matter what, so long as it's got an on signal or something hooked up to the receiving that says that it should be on. So right now I don't have anything hooked up to that. So I have hit F on it, which turned it on. So right now it's off because it's hooked up to that switch. Doesn't matter what else I hit, nothing comes on, doesn't matter. Flip the switch, welcome! Yay, awesome. Alright, but that's a really tiny, puny little welcome. So, we want everyone to see this when they come walking into our base. So what you gotta do with any of these codings of changing the sizes, changing the colors, doing its offsets, anything you want it to do. If you're going to manipulate those words, you're going to need a greater than and a less than symbol, just like that. The less than first, whatever size change, color change, whatever, and then the greater than. That's how it knows to take this and do something specific with it. From there, depending on what you want to do, say we want to make it bigger, so we're just going to do size. All lowercase, do not do any uppercase stuff at all. Size equals, we'll do a 4. So now we'll go ahead and save that. It's got bigger. Still not quite big enough. Let's go bigger. Let's just make a drastic jump here just to show you guys. We'll go size 10. Big! But see, now it doesn't fit. Why doesn't it fit? That's because it's actually trying to always fit it within a 2-block area for whenever it starts. So now to fix that, what we do then is another set of these brackets, because the size is one set, and now we're going to come over here and we're going to do a width. Oop, no capitals. If I can remember how to spell it there for a second. Alright, so we'll do a width. Since we've got that, we'll just assume 5. That should be a decent size for that thing. Welcome. Nice and big. That's awesome. Just like that. So now, you want to have the sign hidden. You can't just sink it in the ground one, because then it's still going to be visible, and you'd sink it any further, and that's going to be in the ground. You're not going to see that. So let's throw it up in the air. The way you do that one, again, same little brackets, step back inside of there, we're going to do an offset. So now it's going to be an offset equals. And now all these units, they're measuring in blocks, one full block. You can do half, you can do a tenth, you can do an eighth. It's all. So let's just do a 3.5. That's going to throw it up 3.5 blocks above this sign. So now it's up in the air. Just like that. Oop. My game is lagging like crazy. You hitting some lag there, Rebel?
I hadn't felt any lag.
I'm not saying you cause it, but...
Yeah, I know. I hadn't felt any lag.
Oof. Alright.
At all.
Oh, every now and then I can't move. I don't know what's going on. Alright, so we got the welcome up in the air. It's larger. What's next? Let's go ahead and change the color. What kind of color do you want, Rebel?
Oh, let's go with red.
Red? Alright, so now there's two separate ways we can do colors. As well, guys, a lot of the times whenever you're using these decimal points, it will like you and want you, and some of them will actually require you to put that little slash right there. So just even as a good practice, go ahead and throw that slash on in there. That ends that little bit of code. I mean, if you got it, they'll all work. If you don't got it, don't necessarily need it on some of them. I tend to usually not do that until I actually need it, just because it saves me some time in writing some of this stuff. Alright, so there's two different ways of doing color. One of them is literally just a color equals red. Oop, not enter. Make sure that it all stays together.
There we go.
Color equals red. I mean, that works with your generics, your reds, blues, green, purple, black. I think that's really about it. I don't even know if it works on some of the other slightly more fancy kinds of colors at all. But then what there is also hexadecimal. Now, hexadecimal, the way that it goes is it takes all forms of color and compares them through a 6-digit number of 0 through F. So your normal binary stuff is ones and zeros. Your normal single digit code entry is 1 or 0 through 9, because as soon as you hit 10, now you've got 2 digits. Well, hexadecimal needs a 6-digit code that has a lot more of a variety. So it does 0 through 9, and then it goes A, B, C, D, E, F. So your reds are going to be on your F side of that. Your blacks and all that sort of stuff are all going to be on the other side. So what we can do, let's just go ahead and throw in some of this. We'll do FF 1122. That's 246. That is 6 digits there. So now that should change it to red. It's a different shade of red, and I can actually show you that by... I want to change out this F with another 1. Yeah, I don't know if you can really notice that change in shade. So we'll do a little bit more of a drastic shade and change cut here.
Ooh.
So I just changed that first F, and now it's that. I mean, this gives you such a wide variety of things. I mean, you can just start throwing random things in here. It doesn't matter what, so long as you have 6 digits that are 0 through F. I mean, I believe all Fs are red. No, all Fs are white. Yeah, all Fs are white. All zeros are black. So you go from one end to the other. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There we go. So now that should be black. So there's lots of websites that you can use that you can look up hexadecimal color codes for whatever, but hexadecimal is the easier way to do it with a lot more variety, because all you need is your little pound symbol and 6 numbers, anywhere from 0 to F. So remember, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, B, C, D, E, F. Any of those. So we'll go back to a nice little red. We'll just go back to this one that I already know on there. FF1122, just because it's simple. It's a nice little red. So now, well, let's actually head on over to this next sign here. We'll cut some of these ties. And we'll use some of this stuff on the next sign. So some of the really cool things are on these signs too, is I think Playful Dave made a comment on this that you can't actually do these, but I believe I've been able to prove him wrong. Which is not all that often that you can prove a member of the Playful team wrong. So yeah, this is going to be awesome if I can do it. I remember I've had it before, but I think it messed up every time I tried to do something specific with it. Alright, so in here, we'll go like this, and we'll do a size equals. So what that's going to do is it's going to only display... what am I doing? It is only going to display when there is an input on 1. So it's a... we'll just do a high on that one. And yeah, Rebel, you can take a look at this as soon as I get it all typed in here and save it.
Alright.
If you think of anything you want to see, Rebel, shoot it out. Let me know. That's kind of one of the reasons why I've got you in here, too.
I'm trying to think here myself.
Yeah. Even if it's something you think can be done and not sure, blurt it out and I can either look it up later or if I know it now. Yeah. Size equals that guy there, another one of those brackets, and it will do a... just do like so. We'll have a little fun with this one. Alright, what kind of a message should we put here? Let's do this. Have a little fun with that one. Alright. So, now the way that this should all go is actually... whenever we trigger one of these connections, just throw down a handful of switches. Whenever we trigger one of these connections, it should actually turn on one of the messages. If I remember it correctly, that I'm doing it right. Let me shut that off so it all resets. Turn off. I believe. Turn it on. Wait, why is this?
No.
Oh, that is really tiny.
Oh God.
All right. So it says hi. Awesome. So it says the first part of the message. Now I shut that off, and the hi goes away. Well, now I turn this one on. It says nice. Awesome. It's working. Hehehe. That was supposed to be the last one.
Oh, that was supposed to be the last one?
Yeah, I flipped the wrong switch.
Looks like it's supposed to have been the last one. I looked in there.
And then bye. So you can set up different messages. I don't think there's a way of actually like changing the size on these though. That's where I was running into an issue. I don't know if you guys can figure anything out. So let me try actually just doing a 3 right there. So that should be hooked up with this switch. Whoa. Wow. Yeah, see, that's the sort of thing that happens when I started messing with the sizes. It was just nonstop displaying it.
Okay.
So you can in fact display multiple messages on one sign at different times, but it's always going to be small. Unless I can possibly find a different way of doing it. Let me try doing it this way. 5. Ooh. Okay. But now big smells. Yeah, okay. So that can work off of keypads. Can work off of sensors, because sensors can display multiple things, but you're going to have to spawn multiple creatures inside of an area that it's going to display something, or multiple people. The more people that are in the sensor, the larger the sign gets, kind of stuff. It's really about the only way that I can think of making that any bit bigger.
Yeah.
But you can do multiple signs at once. So that's how signs work on that as well. So, Playful, come on, man. Playful Dave, come on. You can give multiple messages out of one sign at different times. Just not very big. Alright.
We already figured that one out already.
What's that?
We already figured that one out.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if it's been modified since he made his video saying that, so I don't want to call him out too much on it or anything, because otherwise it's going to come back to bite me, I know.
Yeah.
Alright, we've gotten all that sort of stuff done. Ooh. Next trick. So, I got a handful of this stuff here. So, say this is going to be a wall that you're trying to put this on. Shoot right over that, aren't I? Yep. Alright, so we'll just go ahead and lower that back down. So I only need it to be too high. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back in here and I'm going to change this offset right here. Just the numbers. That's all I need. Back down to 2. Oh, actually just 1. Because it does go 1 unit above it already anyway. So offset of 1. See, so now it's in front of that wall. Awesome. Just what we wanted. But it's still floating. It's just kind of a floating sign. Ooh, I'm falling off my land here.
You're not supposed to be doing that.
I know. So if that sign was buried, you don't want to see that sign. It's gone. And I'm not actually going to bury it because there's too much stuff in the way already. But, so if that sign was buried and you're just trying to make it all hidden and whatnot, you don't really like how that is floating out in the middle there of nowhere. Well, what we can do is there is a nice little thing that Creativerse has added in here. Doesn't really matter where you throw any of these things. You always want these, though, before the words. If you have something after the word, this reads it in order from top down, left to right, just like you'd be reading your normal book, and it says size 10. All right, so it makes the size 10. Width 5. All right, so it makes the width 5. Offset being 1. Okay, it raises it up 1. So now if you then have another size, if you go size 2, it's going to shrink it back down to size 2. So we'll actually just go ahead and just show that. So size equals 2. Oh, what am I doing? We'll just add another one of these brackets here, and we'll just go ahead and delete that one. Alright, so size 2. So now it's going to shrink back down to 2. Because it reads 10, makes it 10, then it reads 2, and makes it 2. So you can have different things being different sizes, different colors in one sign. It's literally pretty much limitless as to what you can all do. What are you dropping?
Nope.
You just dropped a hidden temple accent.
Yeah, and I hit the wrong button too.
I saw a bag drop and all of a sudden you take off. Alright, so we want to slap this right on the wall. So there's a nice little trick that Creativerse added in here. We'll just go ahead and slap it right on in here. Throw another set of those brackets, come back inside of it, and we'll do a Z offset. So you know you got your normal X, Y, Z. Your Z is your horizontal, your front to back. We'll go offset equals, and since we're going to be going backwards from the sign, it's going to be a negative, and we only need to go half a block because the sign actually starts out in the middle, so it's a 0.5 slash, all inside of those little brackets. And then we hit OK, and it's still showing awesome, and it's right on the rock face, or on the dirt face there. So that's what we wanted. And just the same, too, you can remove that negative, and we can change it, so we'll go 3. So now it's going to come towards me 3 units. So it's actually going to end up probably behind me. Yep, it's going to end up behind me. So you can go ahead and move it around, manipulate it, do all that sort of stuff. The only thing that I don't know if anyone's been able to find out how to shift it left or right. I don't think there's a way of doing that. Not sure. Alright, so let me go ahead and put that back on the wall and leave it there. So a negative 0.5, save. Right back on the wall. Alright, and then we've got this one here that is still going ahead and doing the multiple messages. You should pick that guy up because we don't need that there. I'll go ahead and grab you because I'm going to start doing you on over here. Because this is going to be some fun, tricky, intricate craziness. Alright, so I'll do 3 keypads, not 4. So now in here, what we can do, just go ahead and hook all these guys up. So now this is going to be the fun one, because this is going to be some craziness. Since I'm not going to set a auto reset, so they're going to just keep sending that signal, I've got them on 1, 3, and 4. So what we're going to do is we're just going to do a high. No, we're not going to do a high. We're going to have some real fun here. So we're going to do a high. Now, there's this little fun thing as well. If you guys are trying to do any kind of a storyline, if you're trying to welcome anybody, if you're trying to do... I mean, you can, as you guys had seen, I think, in my last video before it got cut off there at the end, you can write literally a essay in these things. There is no limit to how much message you can put in here. So at the beginning, you can do a hi. For me, it would say Bogla. For Big Rebel, it's going to say his name. For whoever else that comes up to it, it's going to say the player's name. The way you do that is the little squirrely brackets, and you type in player name. Just like that. All lowercase still again. And that should say hi, Bogla, to me. And Rebel should be seeing hi, Big Rebel.
Yep.
So that'll say anybody's name, whoever comes up to it that's within basically eyesight of it, it's going to show their name for them. Along with that, just go ahead and put an exclamation point over there. We'll make it a little bit bigger so we can see it. Size equals, we'll go 5 because 5 is good. 5 is fun. What am I doing with these brackets? I'm losing my mind. So we'll go like that. We'll throw it up just a little bit as well. So again, offset equals, we'll go 3. So now this is when the fun with the keypads comes in. So keypads, they will send a signal all the time, whether it's a off signal or whatever number you enter. So, because these guys are set to 0, so they will continually send whatever you enter. Change that width on there, make it a little bit bigger as well, so this is going to be a nice, easy message to read. What is going on? Why am I hitting some crazy lag?
Oh, you didn't lag.
I don't know what's going on. Like, every now and then I just pause and I can't move.
Huh. That's weird.
Equals, we'll go 5 again. again. Close that off. There we go. Alright.
Might be because of all the other stuff you got going on.
It's just Discord, this, OBS, internet.
Yeah.
Just a few programs. No big deal. Alright, so now here is where we get to have some fun. There's a lot of different stuff. Since these are now recording an input of a digit numerical, however you want to put it, a number, and any kind of a number, not just a 1 or 0, you can have some fun. So what we're going to do is actually we're going to allow people to change the colors of this. So the way we're going to do it is you come inside of one of these brackets, you put in your pound symbol like that again, you do a squiggly bracket, 1. You do another squiggly bracket of, wait, not 2 because that one doesn't have any hooked up, so we'll do a 3. And then we'll do another squiggly bracket of a 4. And then we'll go ahead and we'll close it. Because now that pound inside of those brackets says that we're looking for a hexadecimal number. Since I'm calling for 3 different digits, or 3 inputs, any of the numbers, so long as they are two digit numbers that get entered into those keypads, will then give us 6 digits. And that will give us a hexadecimal number. So I'm going to do a 12 in this one. Not going to change it because it's not at a number yet. Out of the hexadecimal, we'll do 52 on that one. Still not going to change it because you can actually see what the displays are up there. Why is that like cutting out? So you can see what I've already entered so far. And now when I enter this last one, it should all disappear and it should change that color. So we'll come in here and we'll do a 78. Maybe a bigger, oh, not 782. Because you can't have that many numbers, so 78, enter. And it's changed the color. So you can even use keypads to change the colors of things. All on how you do these codings. And actually, I'm going to come down here, and I'm just going to have it display what is entered in these things. Oops, wrong button. There we go, 3... and 4. So now this is calling for it to display whatever value as in input 1, input 3, input 2, input 4, all that stuff. So see how I've also got the space in there, so it spaces them out. So those, that is our hexadecimal number of 125278.
Okay.
So Rebel, you want to go in there and you want to just start putting in 2-digit numbers in any of those keypads. And as you do it, that sign should change colors.
Alright, let me get a different position here.
Uh-huh.
Let's go to here. Let's do this.
Yeah, you can see it changing even just shades every time that he enters a different number. It changes a little bit. For every time you come on up here and you enter
okay,
in a new number,
put the number in there.
And every time.
Put it in. Okay.
It'll change. And it all depends upon what kind of numbers you enter in, where, as to the what it'll be. So if I just enter in a bunch of ones, like before we had seen.
We got a flying pixie.
You got a flying pixie?
Yeah, he flew up and came back down.
Oh, he's bouncing off of all sorts of stuff.
Uh-huh.
So that's a little bit of the fun stuff that you can start doing with that sort of stuff. Ooh, there is one other. So now, along with these sorts of signs, what you can actually do... Do I have all the stuff on me? I need you and... you. Let me build a quick little timer. So guys, pro tip of the day right here, remember how to build a timer or a clock. This gets put into so many different things, it is ridiculous. So this is a clock with a switch. So this right here is a clock that will not ever end. It will just keep on going. Because I have an inverter, so it's always putting out a positive signal. And that into there, and that back on into here. And this being a XOR. So now, as well as this is going to have to get set, we'll do a 1 second delay. Alright. Why is that not running? It should be running. Does it need an input signal just to get it started, I think? Maybe? Yeah. And then you can pick this back on up, I think? Nope. Alright, well let's just do it with a switch. It's been a while since I've made one of those kind of clocks. So, the way that this goes is, say the switch is a sensor, your pressure pad, your switch, your whatever. You flip the switch, you turn the system on, this clock is now going to be constantly running. And it is going to do a tick every 1 second. It's going to send a positive signal. So this is a 1 second clock. Just going to be non-stop spitting out a signal. So if I grab a signal right from here, and I hook it up to the receiving node, every second, it'll turn on for a second. So now with a clock, what you can do is you can have a little bit of fun. If you know a little bit of the coding on here, actually I'm going to do it on this one here. So in here, with the size, what I am going to do is I'm going to do a bracket of a input 1 and close that bracket. So now what it's going to do is it's going to fluctuate between a size of 10 and whatever the input value is of input 1. So it should flip between a 10 and a 1. Now that that is connected. Oof, that is not right. Something's wrong there. But you see it twitching,
it's
though.
It's up high.
Yeah. See, that's another one of those sorts of issues where it's like, for some reason, you can't just blow it way up. So let's just shrink it back on down to a 2. No, let's shrink it way back down. And shrink it on down to a 1. Oop, I'm going to have to make it a little bit wider because it's too wide. So we'll change the width to a 6. So a lot of this does take a little bit of trial and error and playing around, but now you see it has a heartbeat to it. Every second it grows and then it shrinks. So that is awesome for some of your signs. If you like want to do a shop or something and you have an open sign, you can do a bunch of that sort of stuff. Or, there's just endless possibilities that you can do with this. I mean, you can even hook this, instead of having it off of a switch, let's just go ahead and cut that and we'll grab it off of the sensor. Stick the sensor into there right now. Okay, why is it actually like running now when it's not hooked up to anything? Alright. There we go. Now it shuts off. So now it shuts off until I go and I stand in it. So long as I'm standing in the sensor zone, it keeps on beating. So I've actually done this to somebody's base. Actually, we're right by it. You want to go take a trip with me, Rebel?
Oh, yeah, let's go.
Let's head on over to Lemon's base. So she is somewhere off this direction, I do believe. Oh, a little to our right.
I'm trying to find you.
She's off this direction.
Oh, all right, go ahead.
Ooh, I did a turn.
I see ya.
Creativerse, you need to make it when you go and look at the map. You don't turn your glider when you move your mouse. I don't know how many times I've done that when I go and look at the map and I try to figure out where I'm going and it's all of a sudden I do a nosedive.
Whoa.
So I gotta go right in over
here.
I had
to figure out why I keep crashing when I shouldn't be crashing.
Are you just like crashing in Creativerse or what?
Yeah.
Wow. Somebody's been busy over here. Holy cow.
Like, I can't even keep my stuff flying straight. Wait a minute, I haven't even got to see this yet.
Lemon has been building. Got some floating trees, though. May want to take care of that, Lemon. But yeah, somebody's been building over here like crazy. So, I did this as a little bit of a fun gag on her the other day. So you can see how it says, Bogla, welcome to Lemon Square's home. And it's got a little bit of a pulse to it. I still want to see if I can make that a little bit bigger of a noticeable pulse or something, but I gotta play around with it. And in here, she had all these signs, but I was just kind of throwing a bunch of different colors onto them and whatever all else. So again, I've got some of them as just the color equals black. Some of these more fancy ones. I think I actually did some of the hexadecimals in one or two of these at least. Yeah, there's a hexadecimal one. That's all I did. Didn't make it bigger, nothing else fancy on that. Just kind of changed the colors. Did you get hurt?
Yep.
Yeah, I know, I got hurt as well. Fell out of the sky once. But now the fun part is, this one here is actually hooked up to a sensor. So, Rebel, if you want to hop on out of the sensor.
Yeah, hang on. Yeah.
Shutting the doors.
Close off.
So, when we hop out of the sensor here, it turns off the message. No one around can see it. You step into the sensor, it displays it for anyone around, and anyone that is looking at it sees their name up top there. So that's a cool little way to greet people and say personalized messages to anyone and everyone who walks up to it. Makes people feel special.
Yeah, it does.
Alright, so we'll head on back to my base.
Alright.
And I think that's actually about all I've got right now for the intro stuff and the little bit more of an in-depth look into signs. Unless you get something else that you know I've done that I'm forgetting or... wanted to see anything.
I can think of. That's the only thing I can think you have done.
Ooh, scoreboard.
I would have liked to know about. Also,
Let me quick show a little bit of a scoreboard.
Oh, yeah.
Let me turn you off. I'll throw you down, because this is literally all I'm looking for, is just your regular generic input. Doesn't really matter.
Okay.
So we'll do a 3x3 here so we can easily stand in it.
I wonder why that happened.
I wonder why what happened.
I totally stopped flying.
You fell a little short?
Yeah, but I didn't press the button to stop flying or anything. It just stopped cold growing. I don't know why that had going on.
I don't know. Alright, so I just made this a 3x3 box here. Now, the way that sensors go is they actually do count and store a numerical value. So they're not just a 0 or a 1. They can build up numbers. So Rebel, if you wouldn't mind joining me over here. So you see, input 1 is 1. That's because I'm the only one standing in it. When Rebel joins in, now input is 2. If I were to put a creature in here, since I'm detecting creatures and people, it would go up to 3. So it just keeps on counting. So if you want it to be a team... all you do is you just change input here to be Team Red. And then you display whatever value is coming from input 1, which is hooked up to this sensor. So Team Red is 1, 2, 1, 2. So it's a way of keeping track of some scores. And then all you have to do for the mechanical side for scores, literally, number comparison gate, sensor into the number comparison gate's input 1, just like you're doing a normal combination lock. Set it for a value. Say we want it to do whatever action on equaling 2, because there's only 2 of us here. And I think I've got some LEDs. Let me throw down some LEDs. I do not have some LEDs, so we're just going to use fireworks.
No.
Fireworks are awesome. I love fireworks.
They're always awesome.
I always have a thing of fireworks on me. Alright, so we're going to hook that back up. So now what's going to happen is that firework is going to go off when this comparison gate shows that input 1 equals input 2. Input 2 is set to a value of 2. So when Rebel steps in there, the scoreboard reads 1. Nothing happens. Nobody will won because we're looking for a score of 2. So now I step in there, we reach our score of 2, the comparison gate sends it onto the firework, and the firework goes off. And somebody's won. Yay! So that's how scoreboards can work and the electronics behind them. So So that's actually about it for that. So let's just go ahead and we can do the number comparison gate with the keypad real quick here. Because then that way we can actually get all the keypad stuff done as well in this video, or at least the majority of the keypad stuff. So I don't think I've got a door. You want to go run in and grab me a door? Do you know where I have them stashed now?
What door here?
Oh, sweet.
I had them all moved from earlier.
Alright, I do have a couple of lights on. Let me throw down some lights so we can actually see what we're doing out here. I need to make like a tech arena.
A tech testing chambers.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll do that later on.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna have to make something nice and fancy. Alright, so we're just gonna go ahead and slap down a little bit of these, and we're gonna throw a little bit of you right. Nope. What is going on here?
What you mess? What?
That's a real effective door right there. I mean, the sad part is it actually kind of is. You can't walk through it. Alright, there we go. So, dirt, door. Let's get you down. There we go, door.
There we go.
Alright, door. Alright, so keypad. I'm just going to do everything is all exposed and visible, so it's a whole lot easier for you guys all to see. But normally, I would go and hide all this stuff down in the ground. All you do is you just dig down to slap whatever electronics down. Oh, that's like three down now. What is going on? Why is that like a giant hole down here? Holy cow. Let me fill a little bit of this in. Whoa, there's a big hole down here.
A lot more than what you thought?
Yeah. Alright, so that's two down. So then what you do is you just go ahead and you throw down your logic, and then you put a piece of dirt over it. Nobody sees it. You can see it if you look it up in the electronics, but yeah, you can't see it down there. So let me go ahead and rip that on out of there. That's how you hide stuff. Wires go through anything. They can go across the world. It doesn't matter. Alright, so wiring up a keypad to a door is simple. When you start getting into more complex combination lock kind of systems, that's when things get tricky. I will go more into that stuff later. This is just your basic intro into keypads. My next video, then, I will do more on keypads. So I'm figuring I'm kind of going to do a little bit of that sort of stuff as a series, where I'll introduce the next one at the end of this current one. So, do a keypad. Again, pro tip of the day, guys. Remember, input one. Always connect to input one first. No matter what you're doing, connect it to input one first. Gives you a lot less problems down the road. So now we want it to equal whatever our code is going to be, so we're just going to do a code of 1 to make it easy for right now for us. We're going to switch it over to value, and then the output of the comparison gate goes to the door. And on the keypad, remember to always set your auto reset time. We'll do it for a 4 second. That's going to mean the door is going to open for 4 seconds before the keypad then sends a zero or a false signal back to that comparison gate, which will then close it. So we press 1 as our keypad and we enter that. Door opens. Yay! And it closes after 4 seconds. Now too, if you want to flip this door around the other direction, you hit flip direction on there. You hit 1 and it should open the other way. Yay! That's how that works. But see, now too, though, you've got a keypad on there and all that sort of stuff. It's all working. It's nice and dandy. But right now, anyone can come running up here, push F, and open my door. The reason being, I did not uncheck this can interact option. You do that, door's locked. It's not going to open no matter how many times I sit here and click on it. It's not going to do nothing. You have to come over here and enter the code. Unless you've got building permissions on that plot. Then you can actually go into it, undo that, and open it. So that is how keypads work. That is how keypads work, guys. Let me check here. Where am I timing at? Oh, we're at 44 minutes already. Okay. So that is actually about all I've got to show you guys today on that sort of stuff. Rebel, you got anything else you want to throw in here?
No, you actually answered my question. I was trying to figure out earlier because I couldn't get my door to work earlier.
Yeah, no problem. So, guys, remember, if you have anything you want me to work on logically for you, anything that you're struggling, stumbling, projects that you're working on, something you want me to build, something you haven't seen, let me know. I will include it in videos. I will work out whatever logic. I will teach. I will show and possibly help build depending on what they are and if I've got time. So go ahead, leave a comment, like, subscribe, let me know what you think about it, let me know what you want to see. Have a good one, guys.